Hello, good morning, everyone. 大家早上好。
Hi, welcome to Scaling Bitcoin. We're really excited to have you all here.
My name is Bobby Lee.
And I'm Victoria Van Eyck.
And we're here to kick off the Scaling Bitcoin conference. So let's make the introductions.
Okay, we have Pindar Wong coming up to do some welcome messages.
Pindar is the chairman of the organizing committee. Let's give a big round of welcome to Pindar.
Okay. Thank you so much. 大家好, welcome to Hong Kong. It's lovely to see many of you from Montreal so soon. Rusty, yeah. So what I'm going to be basically doing is reading the house rules. As you know, what we said in Montreal is that we have a four C's. We have a code of conduct, which you should all have been given. Right? That creates a safe space for neutral discussion. Right? No debates, no decisions. And that's hopefully going to foster communication between the speakers, and most importantly, between yourselves. Hopefully that communication results in collaboration, and hopefully that collaboration results in an emergent kind of consensus. That's not up for us, up to us. Consensus is emergent. That's really up to you. So with that, just some house rules. We have, as you know, in the code of conduct, no attribution policy. It's really one rule, which is we have no attribution. And that also includes photographs. Within this room, no photographs, please. With that, I want to pass you to our program chair, Niha Nirula.
Hi, everyone. Thank you so much for being here. So I know that for a lot of you, it was a lot of time to get here. For other people, taking time on the live stream to participate, we're all here because we care about the future of Bitcoin. And so thank you. And welcome to phase two of the Scaling Bitcoin Workshop here in Hong Kong. So here's what's really different about phase two. We're going to evaluate specific design proposals. So whereas phase one was really about understanding the problem, phase two is about solutions. And that fact went into every aspect of this program design. So we're going to have some BIPs that are already ready to roll, that are already implemented, or could be soon. We're also going to have some presentations that are more forward-looking and about the future of Bitcoin. We're going to have really excellent technical sessions, and we're going to have a panel to learn about the miners. And we're also going to have a lot of dynamic time for discussions to emerge, so we can really talk about these problems and the solutions that are presented today. Now, what's really important to remember is that this is an opportunity. It's not a committee meeting. We're coming together to learn, to evaluate, and to form educated opinions. Implementing solutions that might emerge here still requires time, review, and thorough testing. And so with that, I'd like to introduce the first speaker, Jorge Timon, who's going to be telling us about BIP99 and controversial hard forks. So, Jorge.
Thank you. Is this working? Oh, yeah. So we're going to talk about consensus forks, which are changes to the consensus rules. Not everything in Bitcoin are consensus rules. There's many things that any node can do as they like. But we are going to focus on the consensus rules. And I'm going to give an introduction about basic things, basic classifications and stuff, and then focus on the uncontroversial consensus forks, and the last part is on controversial and disagreements, but I put it the last because maybe I don't have time to go through it. So why do we want to classify consensus forks in the first place? Well, for one thing, we often have long and heated discussions, and many times it's because we don't share a common terminology, we don't have the same definitions, and well, that leads to disagreements. Another advantage of classifying the consensus forks is recommend different deployment strategies for them, and one of the objectives of BIP99 is to make one category that it's uncontroversial hard forks and hopefully deploy one, the first one. So the first classification that it's more commonly used for consensus forks is soft forks versus hard forks. So first, limit the rules further. So things that were invalid, they still all remain invalid, but some things that were previously valid now become invalid. And this is what we've been doing so far, but they are, and they have the advantage that it's backwards compatible. You don't have to adapt your code, and you can still be part of the network. But they have some limitations as well, so that's why I want to deploy Hartford as well. So one category of consensus forks is unintentional hard forks or soft forks. Thing accident happens, there's mistakes in implementations. People don't always implement exactly the specification of the consensus rules. And accidents like this have happened in the past. Does it matter if they're soft forks or hard forks? Should we have different categories for them? I don't think so. We just don't want to do this, right? So the deployment recommendation is try not to deploy this. It's simple. But what is the specification of the consensus rules that people aren't able to exactly follow sometimes anyway? So there's not really a specification. There's some documentation that claims to be the consensus rules, but it's usually outdated and doesn't go into enough detail. One project that several people are working on, it's decoupling the consensus rules from Bitcoin Core, from the rest of Bitcoin Core, because the project is big and the consensus rules are really only a tiny part of that. So far, we have exposed Verify script, which is kind of low level, but it's actually very good because with that you have there most of the crypto and the difficult stuff. But I would like to also expose Verify header, Verify transaction, and Verify block, and maybe hopefully eventually move this to its own repository apart from Bitcoin Core. And when we have that, we will have a formal specification that it's also the implementation, and other alternative implementations different from Bitcoin Core will be able to use. But we don't have that yet. So on controversial softwares, this is what we've been doing so far. I think it has been very successful. It's backward compatible, as we said, because if you don't upgrade to the new rules, it's fine. As long as miners have upgraded, of course. Because miners just won't mine the new blocks that would be invalid with the new rules, and you will just validate fine. Here are a list of deployments that we have done, or in the case of BIP65, it's in the process, but I think it's very advanced. I don't know the percentage of miners that are upgraded, but it's high, I think. So the way we deploy this, at first we used a time threshold. From this time on, the new rules apply, and then we started using is block supermajority, which allowed miners to use the block version to coordinate the deployment. And people sometimes call this miner voting, but I don't like that because it's not something that it's being voted here. These changes were supposed to be completely uncontroversial, and we were expecting all miners to be on board, so they're not voting anything. I prefer to call it upgrade confirmation. Just they are signaling to the rest of the miners that they are ready to implement the new rules. There's a BIP called BIP9 that super majority has the limitation that you have to serialize all the changes, and we cannot deploy several of them in parallel. And BIP9 tries to solve that instead of using the version feel as an integer, we just use the bits individually. Specifically, only 29 bits because three of them have been lost. Well, one for due to the fact that the field was a signed number instead of an unsigned, and two more because we used version 4 for the last one. But I think 29 bits. I don't think we will ever deploy 29 different consensus forks at the same time, so it's fine, probably. So uncontroversial hard fork. That's what we have never done, but I would really like us to do sometime. And here's a little list. There's many more things that we could do, but these are some of the less controversial, I think, and are easy to implement. So they are good candidates, I believe. In the current code of BIP 99, it's only the time warp attack fix that it's implemented, but the other would be easy to include as well. So, well, I could talk a little bit about them. For example, I just mentioned that we lost 3 bits forever. We could fix that with an uncontroversial hard fork. In the scripting language, there's operators that don't do anything. But just return true. But we can use them to deploy soft forks, and there's a limited space, and we could have made that bigger from the beginning, but we didn't. We can fix that too, and recover more bits from the hash. So uncontroversial hard forks. The people want hard forks to be deployed slowly for all the implementations to have time to adapt their software. But we want to have a hard fork as soon as possible, right? How is as long as possible, but long enough at the same time? 5 years? That's probably too much, I think. But I mean, I don't think anybody can see that 5 years is not enough time. And I don't know, we can go, I think 1 year would be fine as well, but we should think about that. So my deployment recommendation for this, and I know many people disagree with this, is using a temporal threshold like with this other times, and also use BIP9. And people don't like this because they say, no, in a hard fork, miners shouldn't have a say, or they shouldn't vote. But like I said, they are not voting. They're just confirming that they are ready because these are supposed to be completely uncontroversial. Miners are not supposed to oppose to these changes. If they did, then it wasn't truly uncontroversial. And for the temporal threshold, we could use the time in the header, but I don't like that much because you don't know if for a given block, you don't know if the next block is going to be using the new rules or not. With the block height, you could know that, and it's very simple. That's the option I like more. But people don't like that because you are not able to plan very, very accurately. Like you can say 1 year from now, but it's not going to be a 1 year. It's going to be one year in terms of chain time, so one median block time year soon. So people prefer to use the median time instead, and I think it's fine. So that's what BIP 99 is gonna be recommend, even though I prefer the height. So another category could be a controversial software that miners decide to collude between themselves, maybe not even doing any voting or any coordination. They would do some coordination, but maybe not coordinating through the chain. And yeah, they could censure certain type of transactions. Maybe they just don't like amounts that are not even, and they censor all odd amounts or whatever stupid thing. And the deployment recommendation is, again, please, miners, don't do this. And then there's hard forks that are controversial in nature. We'll see some examples. If I have time, but the point here is here we don't care about miners, because if we accept that it's gonna be controversial, some miners may oppose to it, and then we don't need or we don't want to use any miner upgrade confirmation mechanism. We just can use a time threshold and that's it. But schism Harford, it's kind of like going to war, and we don't want to kill civilians in a war, right? So here, we don't want to hurt bystanders that don't know what's happening or don't know what the controversy is about. And a way to do that would be to start the controversial hard fork with an end version for the block that it's previously invalid, for example, -1. That has never been valid, and it's not gonna be valid until you do a hard fork. So you can do that, and SPV knows, can tell that that block is invalid according to them, unless their rules have changed. So you force them to look at what's happening. So examples of hard forks, like we said, miners could do things that users don't like, right? So imagine we don't have a block size at all, and we realize that we need one, but miners don't want, because for some reason they prefer bigger blocks. We could limit that with a controversial hard fork that miners may not accept, but it's fine. We won't accept miners bigger than X from now on, even if they mine them. We can do that. But if miners can do something against the users, like they could merge mine the whole chain and only with empty blocks, or I mean, they could retaliate. But or they could do the controversial soft forks, and in those cases, miners are not in power of the rules of the network. If we don't like what miners are doing, we can just make their hardware obsolete by changing the hashing function and making their hardware, their ASICs, worthless. So I think that's one reason why they don't want to do this. They're in controversial software, because we could just change the hashing algorithm. Another example, let's imagine that some evil developers introduce an evil functionality in the code without people noticing, and then we notice, oh, they have done that. Is it irreparable? No, we can fix it with an uncontroversial hard fork, with a controversial hard fork, because maybe the evil developers that did it are not gonna agree with fixing it. That's another example. Another example would be spin-offs. Like there's some altcoins that their initial distribution starts as the current UTXO of the Bitcoin chain. I mean, all altcoins could have been launched like this, and for example, Frycoin could have been launched at Frankfurt or whatever. I think not much would have changed. I mean, we don't have many users, that's true. Most Bitcoiners ignore us, that's fine. But I think if it had been a controversial hard fork instead, the result would have been practically the same. We just wouldn't have been allowed to change some things. Or another example is just fundamental difference on what we want to achieve from the blockchain. With the blockchain, so there's some things that may be unavoidably controversial. But some question that, and I don't think this is very important, but I'll talk about it. Because many people claim that in controversial hard fork, one side eventually has to surrender and go with whatever the hashing majority or the economic majority or whatever goes. And that's not true. You can be persistent or tenacious or stubborn, whatever you want to call it, and don't agree with the rules you don't want. And yeah, people can disagree for forever or for unbounded amounts of time. Some people deny that, but that's great because that's an example of something that it's an open disagreement, right? So people don't have to follow the majority, whatever you mean by majority. If it's miners, as we have shown, we can fork miners out. If it's user, you cannot even know about that because you cannot know how many users are using which software. And if it's the economic majority, whatever that means, it doesn't guarantee unification either. I will repeat the Fryfork example. Frycoiners would be still using the Fryfork chain if it was a controversial hard fork. Bitcoins would have not moved, all Bitcoiners would have not moved to Fryfork. Some users like me would be using both chains. There's no reason why there always have to be a unification there. But I don't think that this point is very important because there's really lots of pressures to unify, especially if it's not very clear that there's a difference in fundamental values there. But yeah, I mean, even if this wasn't true, I think it's not very important. That's why I left it for the end. So if you have questions.
Yeah, we'll take any questions that people have. They should be technical in nature. Does anybody have any questions? No questions at all. Okay.
With a system hard fork, you would end up having the natural economic balance between the two forks based upon trading between them.
Uh-huh. Yeah.
And I think that's an important point.
Yeah, that's an important point to factor with regards to the pressures for unification, right? But it could be that just one falls in price, the other doesn't, or it can be anything happening there. And in fact, in BIP99, we mentioned that there's you cannot predict what will happen because you cannot predict demand for the two chains. But yeah, one way they could be unified is by one of the sites going to zero in the markets or near zero. That could happen, yeah.
Anybody else have any other questions?
Do you think it's worth differentiating between hard forks that are undetectable to SPV clients versus hard forks that are would require a global upgrade?
With controversial, maybe leave the microphone there, because with controversial hard forks, what we recommend is making it visible to SPV miners. And one might be a good reason to use BIP9 with uncontroversial hard forks so that SPV can tell as well. I think it's something good that they always can tell that something's happening, even if they don't know what.
Any other questions? Okay, thank you very much for your presentation.
Thank you.
We're going to have Adam back, who's going to be talking about fungibility and scalability.
So I think everybody knows what fungibility means, that all coins are equal and interchangeable, and it's obviously an important property for an electronic cash system. There's a breakdown in fungibility, all Bitcoin users start to have a problem. Bitcoin is unusual versus previous privacy technology systems in that it has fungibility without privacy. Previous electronic cash systems usually provided fungibility via cryptographic blinding. And in Bitcoin, that's achieved via decentralized mining, that somebody will process your transactions even if a given miner may not, on policy reasons. Though there is some privacy because it's pseudonym-based, and there's some ambiguity from change addresses versus the payment address on the output side. And there are various things we'll talk about that are currently deployed or deployable. And the types of privacy that people might be interested in are a range of things. So the obvious one is linkability, i.e. who's paying who. Another one is the balance privacy, how many Bitcoins you have in your wallet. And the transaction privacy, how much was the payment value of a given transaction. So one of the main kind of point I wanted to make in this presentation is about the positive as well as the negative aspects of introducing fungibility mechanisms. So typically we've seen from fungibility mechanisms that they either increase the number of transactions or they increase the size of transactions. You know, for example, we've seen that the zero coin transactions are 30 kilobytes or thereabouts, and some of the mechanisms also increase the UTXO size as a side effect, which is also undesirable for sort of node size or scalability and performance and so forth. So the observation I wanted to make is that some of the more advanced fungibility mechanisms can actually reduce the number of transactions and also potentially reduce the UTXO size. So the obvious and simple fungibility mechanism is a one-use address. And so I'll just quickly recap what that does, costs and benefits. So it slightly obscures who is paying who, at least compared to a single fully reused address as some of the earliest smartphone wallets used to do. It partly obscures the wallet balance because your coins are spread across multiple addresses and people out on the network may not know that all of these addresses belong to one user, though often if you're using a smartphone wallet, the Bloom filter is actually not very privacy preserving, and so that defense is quite weak at present. It creates fragmentation, so it creates more addresses, increases the number of transactions, and it increases the average size of transaction because you'll be combining some of these fragmented values from your wallet. It also increases the UTXO size because each user will tend to have more unspent transactions as a result of the fragmentation. It's also only moderately effective, as we've had a number of academic publications analyzing the network and showing that the effectiveness of this approach is a little weak. So one thing that can be done to reduce the linking coming from having multiple inputs to the same transaction is to use merge avoidance, and that means to make multiple independent transactions from various addresses of the sender to various addresses of the receiver. So this is something that can be done, for example, at the payment protocol level. So something else that is buildable using the existing protocols and deployed in some places on the server side or even in a peer-to-peer format in the wallets is CoinJoin and the related CoinSwap. It's an improvement over one-use addresses. So you have shared input addresses from, just to recap how that works, shared input addresses from different users. So there's nothing preventing a transaction having inputs coming from different users. So it just combines the inputs from different users and ensures the outputs correspond to whatever payments the users would have made, combined into a unified transaction that pays each of the outputs and each of the change addresses. There are restrictions, so you need the values involved to provide actual ambiguity, which wouldn't by default have to be the case. Obviously, you gain no privacy if it's unambiguous as to who could have paid made a given payment due to the input amounts, for example. A disadvantage of this is you need to coordinate with other spenders, so it can slow things down. And it's also vulnerable to some kind of civil attack because some spenders may actually be attacking the system. So they may be offering to mix their payments with yours, but actually just trying to fill up the transaction set so that you're the only person that isn't the attacker. And these protocols are able to, in some of the more advanced versions, to be trustless. So the person operating the server, for example, or the peer-to-peer mechanism, can't steal the coins, they can only stall it. Confidential transactions, so I mentioned at the beginning a number of different types of privacy. So confidential transactions are most directly interested in protecting the transaction value, so the amounts in the transaction from the observer. So it turns out that using some relatively conservative cryptographic primitives, basically the same mechanisms used by ECDSA signatures, that one can hide the values from the network. So it's the value of the transaction is visible only to the sender and the recipient, and yet the network can still validate what it needs to validate, i.e. that the values involved add up, the inputs add up to the outputs plus fees. So less obvious is that this mechanism provides some indirect privacy improvement. The change is more ambiguous because you won't see sort of $20 going in and $13.99 going out, with the rest probably being change, given specific amounts and the exchange rate. So change is more ambiguous. You could also add, just send preemptively zero valid transactions to other people. So that would add ambiguity that wouldn't otherwise be possible. CoinJoin becomes more effective because you can kind of get perfect coin joins. You can combine any set of coins with any other set of coins in a coin join, and it's fully ambiguous as to who's paying who without any extra restrictions on the input and output amounts. So now come to an example of the kind of trade-off here. So the transaction size with the confidential transactions is maybe 6 times larger, depends on the number of inputs and outputs and so forth. And I have a new sort of small improvement that might take that to 5 times. So the argument is, would we deploy something like confidential transactions within Bitcoin main? And given that they're 5 times bigger and that uses block space that we might otherwise use for scaling, that presents a tough choice. So the point I wanted to make is that actually these transactions are providing more functionality per transaction. So they're in some sense, there's an opportunity there to compress in an indirect way. So a single coin joined confidential transaction or a single confidential transaction actually can replace multiple standard transactions because you don't need to, so to the extent that these mechanisms are used, it reduces overhead. So you don't need to use merge avoidance. You can do that with a single transaction. You get balanced privacy, and some people have tried to obtain balanced privacy by intentionally splitting up their Bitcoin holdings into multiple HD wallet addresses. And similarly, people have done that for value privacy, like with merge avoidance or making multiple payments. And also you end up with a smaller UTXO set because you have less fragmentation in wallets. Now it's hard to evaluate the average reclaim space, but we might get closer to an acceptable new overhead or even neutral on overhead. And so we would need to do some kind of anonymized data collection with collaboration of users or something to work out the actual uses of these different types of merge avoidance and multiple addresses and so forth, because by design that's not always obvious on the network. Another type of fungibility mechanism is the linkable ring signature used in some altcoins. So it's slightly better than CoinJoin because the sender can choose the mix set and you don't need to coordinate in an online fashion. Unfortunately, the values being, each coin going into the ring sig must have exactly the same value, so that's quite restricted in its usability. The linkability is what prevents double spending, and a side effect of these is that it's not UTXO compatible, so we get kind of ever-growing UTXO. And the overhead is the ring signature is linear in the size of the mix set, so you're going to choose, let's say five possible other inputs, and your signature will be approximately five times larger. There might be a small saving here, which is you're less reliant on one-use addresses for reducing linkability. So the other sort of more powerful class of fungibility or privacy mechanisms is the zero coin and zero cash protocols, and these are relatively idealized. They hide the sender and the recipient. Unfortunately, they're not UTXO compatible, so you get an ever-growing UTXO set or double spend database. Zero cash hides the values. Zero coin doesn't hide the values, so you have to each kind of set of zero coins have a denomination, and you only have privacy within the denomination. And there is at least one, maybe several zero coin extensions that hide the value also. The zero coin transactions are quite large. It depends on optimizations and the security parameter choices. Zero cache is more practical on a size basis, but CPU expensive and using some very bleeding edge crypto, which we have less confidence in because of the short amount of time it's had for peer review and the relatively new types of assumptions being used. And both of those systems have a key setup trapdoor and various countermeasures to improve the acceptability of that. But otherwise, as I say, zero cache is quite ideal for fungibility and privacy. Another type of fungibility mechanism that I proposed some time ago is an encrypted transaction, or previously called a committed transaction. And it follows the normal Bitcoin model that you can provide fungibility without privacy. So this doesn't actually provide any new privacy at all, and yet it improves fungibility. And the way that works is you have a two-phase validation. So in the first phase, miners are able to tell that a transaction hasn't been spent. And in the second phase, they learn who's paying, which address is paying which other address, and the amounts and so forth. And so the idea is that in the first phase, the miners have to mine the transaction, and the second phase happens, let's say, a day later or something. And in the second phase, all the miners learn an encryption key, which allows them to decrypt the first phase transaction, tell that it's valid, and then do the final stage approval. And the advantage is that there's a deterrent to censoring the second stage transaction, because the first stage is already mined, and basically the protocol can have a consensus rule that you have to approve all valid second stage transactions, otherwise your only opportunity to mine would be to try and orphan the entire day's work, which is quite expensive. So a related topic with fungibility is the sort of trade-off with privacy and identity. So Bitcoin is a intentionally identity-less system, so it's permissionless, and you can operate it and sign up and use it without an account. You don't need to register anywhere. And so I think what we want to achieve as a kind of design target for internet protocols in general and for Bitcoin is to avoid it being trivial to do preemptive mass surveillance as a default. I.e., investigations are always going to be possible, but as long as there is some kind of incremental cost to conducting an investigation, we can retain societal norms. So, you know, some people have tried to argue against privacy features in electronic cash on a basis, you know, to improve privacy in Bitcoin on a basis that that would make it, you know, too anonymous or something. But I think that's not really a concern overall. And I spent quite a bit more time talking through the reasons for that in this linked video in the past. So I'm probably running fast here, but anyway, so a summary of the trade-offs here that I wanted to make to say that some of these advanced fungibility systems might be more deployable than we previously thought because you do reclaim some space ahead. So the high level is that we, to evaluate it, we actually need to consider more than just the raw size or space overhead. We also have to consider the delivered fungibility and the savings in UTXO and the number of transactions that would otherwise have been used, because we're introducing a new, more powerful type of transaction that can potentially replace multiple simpler transactions or transaction usage patterns. To actually evaluate that and put some numbers to it, we would need to collect anonymized data about the usage patterns and overhead, how common, you know, coin join and merge avoidance and so forth are. Or another way to look at it may be that, you know, people are making do with very little privacy where that they would actually prefer more privacy. So perhaps they're willing to pay for it if it were available. And so at least it would be good to provide an improved range of trade-offs for users so we can find out what they would pay for, what they would like to use. Some users may be willing to pay more for privacy if it's available. And some other users, you know, sort of high-scale, low-value transactions are presumably not typically as sensitive to fungibility because they have, you know, just some micropayments at stake if those got subjected to some kind of policy or lockup. It wouldn't be that affecting. They could just like, forget about the small amount of money they'd put into it. So overall, we want to improve flexibility and allow users to make economic choices. And fungibility itself is very important and a core part of the permissionlessness of Bitcoin. So I think we do have some work to do on fungibility. Bitcoin's fungibility could definitely do with some improvements. And in summary, it's my kind of conclusion that fungibility solutions are more practical than we'd otherwise think if we also take into account the reclaim of transactions, number of transactions and transaction usages from the simpler methods people are using at the moment. So that's the end of the presentation part.
Okay, thanks Adam. We'll now take technical questions.
Over here. Yep. Go ahead. Yep.
You're next. Hey, would you agree that that chaining several conjoined transactions improves a conjoin in general and the privacy behind it? And with confidential transactions, would one conjoin be enough to completely break the link of coins? Thank you.
I guess chaining coin joins presumably helps, and a confidential transaction coin join is more powerful because you have to wait, you know, you can choose any set of transactions. You don't have to wait for qualifying ones that have an ambiguous range of values. So in general, it improves the effectiveness of coin join, and you can also mix in, you know, zero value transactions as well as a secondary method.
You had talked about Zero Cash being kind of a nearly ideal solution with a couple of caveats around it, you know, one being the processor cost and the other being a risk around new crypto. Both of those issues seem like they solve themselves over time. The question is how much time? So how much extra CPU, you know, do they consume compared to normal transactions, and how risky is the crypto in terms of how long do you think it would take before people started to feel comfortable around the security of it?
So the next speaker may have some things to say about this, but I think the CPU cost, you know, obviously CPUs become more efficient, so that will partly improve itself, and perhaps we can sort of combine a hybrid between smartphone wallets and desktop servers to improve some of the performance, but the crypto protocol is kind of more difficult because it depends how conservative you want to be. You know, so the Bitcoin existing crypto assumptions are extremely old assumptions, you know, 20, 30 years old, and so we have very high confidence in them. Whereas the Snark crypto, and even, I mean, the whale pairing has been around for a while, but not as actively used. I mean, you know, like 20 years, but not as actively used. So we don't know as much kind of practical applied research has gone into attacking them. And then there are these all new assumptions that go into them, and it's also a very rapidly evolving space. And the other challenge that I mentioned is the sort of setup trapdoor. The person setting it up has a private key of some kind that they should delete. So there are some variants that don't have that problem.
We have a question from IRC. Which of these proposals would be more likely to have BIPs written in the near future?
Interesting question. Perhaps confidential transactions is closest in that that is actually implemented within the sidechain elements open source release, so people can look at that. Also, potentially, if the protocol can have its space overhead lowered. So I have made some progress and made a 24% space overhead reduction. If we can get a breakthrough on that, that might bring the viability forward for integration.
Hi, where are you going?
There's one at the back.
Hey, 我这里有一个问题哈。 那个我知道 Blockstream 是做这个测链的是吧？然后呢，这个测链其实对解决这个比特币的扩展性还是有很大的帮助作用的。然后但是我发现那个在测链里面也有个私密交易叫做 confidential transaction，但是这样的交易，等一下，等我先说一下。So
Blockstream does side chain transactions. And sidechain transactions helps with the scalability. But inside some sidechain transactions, there are some confidential TXs.
你继续吧。但是那个就是说这样的私密交易带来的这个就是说容量的扩张可能也是比较就是显著的，就是说带来这个交易的字节数的增长也是比较显著的。所以如果说是
So the question is, in sidechains, if we're too emphasizing on confidential transactions, does that limit the scalability of sidechains for Bitcoin?
So in the sidechain elements alpha, the confidential transaction is default, but you could disable it. So it's an optional feature and not, you know, I mean, you can have sidechains without it. As I was trying to articulate in the presentation, even though the sort of the average transaction goes to 2.5 kilobytes or potentially 2 kilobytes with some more recent, not yet implemented improvements, it is providing more value, more functionality per transaction. So in general, you should need less transactions. So the overhead is not as high as it sounds. And we've heard, you know, a range of, you know, users have seemed quite interested in it. The financial institutions that are thinking about share-related uses for blockchains are also quite interested to see some kind of commercial confidentiality. So it seems to be something that's in demand across the full set of Bitcoin users.
Okay, who has the next question over here? Raise your hand if you have more questions.
In encrypted transactions, there's two steps, and the second step is the one I'm afraid that miners will censor, right?
Yes.
So what happens if I never publish the second step and they cannot mine a valid block?
Yeah, so I skipped over the details there. So it's time lock encrypted and it has to be provably decryptable at the time you publish the first phase. So that means if you publish it and then you fail to publish the key, then anybody can decrypt it. It just takes a sequential execution on a CPU core.
So can I talk about the anonymization? If you do the kind of anonymization, it emphasizes that 6 times larger of the blockchain size will be 5 times improvement. The question is, if there are less, I mean, if there are less, if there are less full node wallet users, and the if there, even if there are more miners, it won't be very helpful for me. Both, if there are more valid blockchain copies, and then there will be better safe the security. More miners doesn't mean any helpful. Not everyone can. I mean, not everyone can afford the just a large amount of gigabytes, and if the most of the transactions to the users are useless, and at most they can have the Bitcoin to be security, and anonymization for now is good enough, and I don't really believe that.
What is your question?
Sorry. How can we ensure that everyone with the blockchain, valid blockchain, will continue to use the Bitcoin full node wallet under the anonymized Bitcoin blockchain, I mean the 6 times larger blockchain?
Right. So, I mean, it is a trade-off. And so mainly I was arguing that the overhead is maybe less than it seems at first, because we say, oh, it's 5 times worse, that's too much, we can't use it. So if we go and do the analysis and find that, you know, in the best case, while each confidential transaction would replace 5 regular transactions, then maybe it could be the same overhead, and that would surprise us. Now, probably it's not as effective as that, but that's an interesting situation. So, you know, if we can collect the information about the amount of transactions, you know, the amount of fragmentation in wallets, and the amount of extra transactions that arise purely from attempts to get value privacy, it can give us an indication. And also there is hope that we can improve the space overhead of confidential transactions. So we've already recently managed to reduce it from 6 times to, so from 2.5 kilobytes to slightly under 2 kilobytes. If we can reduce it, you know, quite a bit more, and while it still remains larger than a standard transaction, we can maybe estimate the amount of regular transactions it can replace to provide the same or better functionality to users. So it may be that it's not yet practical to deploy something that's 6 times larger, particularly right now, but it shows that there might be a crossover point where if we can make the size of the average confidential transaction smaller, and we can go and measure how many regular transactions it would replace in functionality terms on average, then we can make a case to deploy it sooner than people would otherwise expect. Even within the main chain, rather than in opt-in side chains.
Let's thank our speaker. And next up is Madars Virza, who's going to be telling us about zero-knowledge proofs for Bitcoin scalability and beyond.
All right. Hey, guys. I'm Madars from MIT, also affiliated with Zcash. And today, I'm going to tell you about zero-knowledge proofs for Bitcoin scalability and beyond. Even though this is an overview talk, many of the results I'll be telling you about are based on joint works with people you see on the slide. Some of them are even here at Scaling Bitcoin. So let's begin. A quick outline for my talk. First, I will give a very brief introduction to zero-knowledge proofs. And then I'll try to convince you that if you care about Bitcoin scalability, you should definitely care about zero-knowledge proofs, and you should keep them on your radar. And if you're convinced of that, then you should be asking yourself, where can I get those zero-knowledge proofs in practice? So the last part of my talk is going to be zero-knowledge in practice, where to get zero-knowledge proofs, how to program zero-knowledge proofs, and how to deploy zero-knowledge proofs. So I'm going to start by introducing zero knowledge. It's a very beautiful notion by Goldwasser, Mikhaly, and Rakov, developed in late 80s, and it concerns the following three objects: a relation, a prover, and a verifier. Relation is just set of pairs, instance, and witness. And if it sounds intimidating, then consider the following example relation: the relation of circuit satisfiability. The instance here is a circuit, and witness is the satisfying assignment. And instance witness pair is in the relation if and only if the circuit outputs one on the input. Okay. Both prover and verifier know the instance, in this case the circuit, and prover additionally knows the witness. And prover wants to convince the verifier